The World by John Charles Ryle, also known as J.C. Ryle, 1816 to 1900. Text, 2 Corinthians 6:17. Come out from among them and be ye separate, saith the Lord. The text which heads these pages touches on a subject of vast importance in religion. The subject is the great duty of separation from the world. This is the point which Paul had in view when he wrote to the Corinthians, come out, be separate. The subject is one which demands the best attention of all who profess and call themselves Christians. In every age of the church, separation from the world has always been one of the grand evidences of a work of grace in the heart. He that has really been born of the Spirit and made a new creature in Jesus Christ has always endeavored to come out from the world and live a separate life. They who have only the name of Christian without the reality have always refused to come out and be separate from the world. The subject perhaps was never more important than it is in the present day. There is a widely spread desire to make things pleasant in religion, to saw off the corners and edges of the cross, and to avoid as far as possible self-denial. On every side we hear professing Christians declaring loudly that we must not be narrow and exclusive, and that there is no harm in many things which the holiest saints of old thought bad for their souls. We may go anywhere and do anything and keep any company and plunge into anything, and all the while may be very good Christians. This is the maxim of thousands. In a day like this, I think it good to raise a warning voice and invite attention to the teaching of God's word, come out and be separate. There are 4 points which I'll try to show in my readers in examining this mighty subject. Number one, I'll try to show that the world is a source of great danger to the soul. Number two, I shall try to show what is not meant by separation from the world. Number three, I shall try to show what real separation from the world consists. Number four, I shall try to show the secret of victory over the world. And now before I go a single step further, let me warn every reader that he will never understand this subject unless he first understands what a true Christian is. If you are one of those unhappy people who think everybody who goes to a place of worship is a Christian, no matter how he lives or what he believes, I fear you will care little about separation from the world. But if you read your Bible and are in earnest about your soul, you will know that there are 2 classes of Christians, converted and unconverted. You will know that what the Jews were among the nations under the Old Testament is what true Christian is meant to be under the New. You will understand what I mean when I say that true Christians are meant in like manner to be a peculiar people under the gospel, and that there must be a difference between believers and unbelievers. To you, therefore, I make a special appeal this day. While many avoid the subject of separation from the world, positively hate it and are puzzled by it, give me your attention while I try to show you the thing as it is. Number one, let me show you that the world is a source of great danger to the soul. By the world, let it be remembered, I do not mean the material world on the face of which we are living and moving. He that pretends to say that anything which God has created in the heavens above or in the earth beneath in itself is harmful to man's soul is unreasonable and absurd. On the contrary, the sun, moon, and stars, the mountains, the valleys, the plains, the seas, lakes, and rivers, the animal and vegetable creatures, all are in themselves very good. Genesis 1:31. All are full of lessons of God's wisdom and power, and all proclaim daily, the hand that made us is divine. The idea that matter is itself sinful and foolish and corrupt is a foolish heresy. When I speak of the world, I mean those people who think only or chiefly of the world's things and neglect the world to come. The people who are always thinking more of earth than heaven, more of time than eternity, more of body than of soul, more of pleasing man than of pleasing God. It is of them and their ways, habits, customs, opinions, practice, taste, aim, spirit, and tone that I am speaking when I speak of the world. And this is the world from which St. Paul tells us to come out and be separate. That is, the world, in this sense, is an enemy to the soul. The well-known catechism teaches this at the very beginning and tells us that there are 3 things which a baptized Christian is bound to renounce and give up. And these 3 enemies which we ought to fight with and resist, these 3 things are the flesh, the devil, and the world. All 3 are terrible foe, and all 3 must be overcome if we would be saved. But whatever men please to think about the catechism, we shall do well to turn to the testimony of the Holy Scripture. If the text I'm about to quote do not prove that the world is a source of danger to the soul, there's no meaning in the words. Well, let's hear what Paul says. Romans 12:2. Do not be conformed to the world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind. We have received not the spirit of the world, but the spirit which is of God. 1 Corinthians 2:2. Christ gave himself for us that he might deliver us from the present evil world. Galatians 1:4. In times past, you walked according to the course of this world, Ephesians 2:2. Demas hath forsaken me, having loved this present world, 2 Timothy 4:10. Let us hear what James says. James 1:27, pure religion and undefiled before God and the Father is this, to visit the fatherless and widows in their affliction and to keep oneself unspotted from the world. James 4:4, know ye not that friendship of the world is enmity with God? Whosoever therefore will be a friend of the world is an enemy of God. Let us hear what John says. Love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. If any man love the world, and the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life, is not of the Father, but is of the world. And the world passeth away in the lust thereof. But he that doeth the will of God abideth forever. 1 John 3:1, the world knoweth us not, because it knew him not. 1 John 4:5, they are of the world, therefore speak they of the world, and the world heareth them. 1 John 5:4, whoever is born of God overcometh the world. In 1 John 5:19, we know that we are of God, and the whole world lieth in wickedness. Let us hear lastly what the Lord Jesus Christ has to say. Matthew 13:22, the cares of the world choke out the word, and it becomes unfruitful. John 8:23, ye are of this world, I am not of this world. John 14:17, the spirit of truth whom the world cannot receive, because it seeth him not, neither knoweth him. And then John 15:18, if the world hate you, you know that it hated me before it hated you. John 15:19, if you were of the world would love his own. But because you are not of the world, but I have chosen you out of the world, therefore the world hateth you. John 16:33, in the world you will have tribulation, but be of good cheer, I have overcome the world. In John 17:16, they are not of the world, even as I am not of the world. I make no comment on these 21 texts. They speak for themselves. If anyone can read them carefully and fail to see that the world is an enemy to the Christian soul and that there is utter opposition between the friendship of the world and the friendship of Christ, he is past the reach of argument, and it is a waste of time to reason with him. To my eyes, they contain a lesson as clear as the sun at noonday. I turn from Scripture to matters of fact and experience. I appeal to any old Christian who keeps his own eyes open and knows what is going on in the churches. I ask him whether it be true that nothing damages the cause of religion so much as the world. It is not open sin or open unbelief which robs Christ of his possessing servant so much as love of the world. The fear of the world, the cares of the world, the business of the world, the money of the world, the pleasures of the world, and the desire to keep in and with the world. This is a great rock in which thousands of young people are continually making shipwreck. They do not object to any article of the Christian faith. They do not deliberately choose evil and openly rebel against God. They hope somehow to get to heaven at last, and they think it proper to have some religion. But they cannot give up their idol. They must have the world. And so after running well and biding fair for heaven while boys and girls, they turn aside when they become men and women and go down the broad way which leads to destruction. They begin with Abraham and Moses and end with Demas and Lot's wife. The last day alone will prove how many souls the world has slain. Hundreds will be found to have been trained in religious families and to have known the gospel from their very childhood, and yet missed heaven. They left the harbor of home with bright prospects and launched forth on the ocean of life with a father's blessing and a mother's prayers. And then got out of the right course through the seductions of the world and ended their voyage in shallows and in misery. It is only a sorrowful story to tell. It is a sorrowful story to tell, but alas, it is only too common. I cannot wonder that Paul says, come out and be ye separate. Number two. Let me now try to show what does not constitute separation from the world. This point is one which requires clearing up. There are many mistakes made about it. You will sometimes see sincere and well-meaning Christians doing things which God never intended them to do in the matter of separation from the world, and honestly believing that they are in the path of duty. Their mistakes often do great harm. They give occasion to the wicked to ridicule all religion and supply them with an excuse for having none. They cause the way of truth to be evil spoken of and add to the offense of the cross. I think it a plain duty to make a few remarks on the subject. We must never forget that it is possible to be very much in earnest and to think we are doing God service when in reality we are making some great mistake. There is such a thing as zeal not according to knowledge. John 16:2, Romans 10:2. There are a few things about which it is so important to pray for right judgment and sanctified common sense as about separation from the world. A. When Paul said come out and be separate, he did not mean that Christians ought to give up all worldly callings, trades, professions, and businesses. He did not forbid men to be soldiers, sailors, lawyers, doctors, merchants, bankers, shopkeepers, or tradesmen. There is not a word in the New Testament to justify such a line of conduct. Cornelius the centurion, Luke the physician, and Zenas the lawyer are examples of the contrary. Idleness in itself is a sin. A lawful calling is a remedy against temptation. If any man will not work, let him neither eat. 2 Thessalonians 3:10. to give up any business of life which is not necessarily sinful to the wicked and the devil from fear of getting harm from it is lazy, cowardly conduct. The right way is to carry out religion into our business and not to give up business under the specious pretense that it interferes with our religion. B. When Paul said come out and be separate, he did not mean that Christians ought to decline all interaction with unconverted people and refuse to go into their society. There is no warrant for such conduct in the New Testament. Our Lord and his disciples did not refuse to go to a marriage feast or sit at a meal at the Pharisees' table. Paul did not say, if any of them that believe not bid you to a feast, you must not go, but only tells us how to behave if we do go. 1 Corinthians 10:27. Moreover, it is a dangerous thing to begin judging people too closely and determining who are converted and who are not, and what society is godly and what ungodly. We are sure to make mistakes. Above all, such a course of life would cut us off from many opportunities of doing good. If we carry our master with us wherever we go, who can tell, but we may save some and get no harm. 1 Corinthians 9:22. C. When Paul says come out and be separate, he did not mean that Christians ought to take no interest in anything on earth except religion, to neglect science, art, literature, and politics, to read nothing of that which is not directly spiritual, to know nothing about what is going on among mankind and never look at a newspaper, to care nothing about the government of one's own country, and to be utterly indifferent as to who guide its councils and make its laws. All this may seem very right and proper in the eyes of some people, but I think it is an idle, selfish, neglective duty. Paul knew the value of good government as one of the main helps to our living a quiet and peaceable life in all godliness and honesty, 1 Timothy 2:2. Paul was not ashamed to read heathen writers and to quote their words in his speeches and writings. He did not think it beneath him to show an acquaintance with laws and customs and callings of the world in the illustrations he gave from them. Christians who plume themselves on their ignorance of secular things are precisely the Christians who bring religion into contempt. I knew the case of a blacksmith who would not come to hear his clergyman preach the gospel until he found out that he knew the properties of iron. Then he came. When Paul said come out and be separate, he did not mean that Christians should be singular, eccentric, and peculiar in their dress, manners, demeanor, and voice. Anything which attracts notice in these matters is most objectionable and ought to be carefully avoided. To wear clothes of such a color or made in such a fashion that when you go into company, every eye is fixed on you and you are the object of general observation is an enormous mistake. It gives occasion to the wicked to ridicule religion and looks self-righteous and affected. There is not the slightest proof that our Lord, his apostles, Priscilla, Persis, or their companions did not dress and behave just like others in their own ranks of life. On the other hand, one of the many charges the Lord brings against the Pharisees was that of making broad their phylacteries and enlarging the border of their garments so as to be seen of men. Matthew 23:5. True sanctity and sanctimoniousness are entirely different things. Those who try to show their unworldliness by wearing conspicuously ugly clothes or by speaking in a whiny, snuffling voice or by affecting an unnatural slavishness, humility, and gravity of manner miss their mark altogether and only give occasion to the enemies of the Lord to blaspheme. E. When Paul said come out and be separate, he did not mean that Christians ought to retire from the company of mankind and shut themselves up in solitude. It is one of the crying errors of Roman Catholic Church to suppose that eminent holiness is attained by such practices. It is the unhappy delusion of the whole army of monks, nuns, and hermits. Separation of this kind is not according to the mind of Christ. He says distinctly in his last prayer, I pray not that thou shouldest take them out of the world, but thou shouldest keep us from the evil. John 17:15. There's not a word in the Acts or epistles to recommend such a separation. True believers are always represented as mixing in the world, doing their duty in it, and glorifying God by patient meekness, purity, and courage in the several positions, not by cowardly desertion of them. Moreover, it is foolish to suppose that we can keep the world and the devil out of our hearts by going into holes and corners. True religion and unworldliness are best seen not in timidly forsaking of the post which God has allotted to us, but in manfully standing our ground and showing the power of the grace to overcome evil. F. Last but not least, when Paul said come out and be separate, he did not mean that Christians ought to withdraw from every church in which there are unconverted members, or refuse to worship in company with any who are not believers, or to keep away from the Lord's table if any ungodly people go up to it. This is a very common but very grievous mistake. There is not a text in the New Testament to justify it. It ought to be condemned as pure invention of man. Our Lord Jesus himself deliberately allowed Judas Iscariot to be an apostle for 3 years and gave him the Lord's Supper. He has taught us in the parable of the wheat and tares that unconverted and converted be together until the harvest and cannot be divided. Matthew 13:30. In the epistle of the seven churches and in all of Paul's epistles, we often see faults and corruptions mentioned and reproved, but we are never told that they justify desertion of the assembly or neglect of ordinances. In short, we must not look for a perfect church, a perfect congregation, and a perfect company of communicants until the marriage supper of the Lamb. If others are unworthy churchmen or unworthy partakers of the Lord's Supper, their sin is theirs and not ours. We are not their judges. But to separate ourselves from church assemblies and deprive ourselves of Christian ordinances because others use them unworthily is to take up a foolish, unreasonable, and unscriptural position. It is not the mind of Christ, and it certainly is not Paul's idea of separation from the world. I commend these 6 points to the calm consideration of all who wish to understand the subject of separation from the world. About each and all of them, far more might be said than I have space to say here. About each and all of them, I have seen so many mistakes made and so much misery and unhappiness caused that I want to put Christians on their guard. I want them not to take up positions hastily in the zeal of their first love, which they will afterwards be obliged to give up. I leave this part of my subject with 2 pieces of advice which I offer especially to young Christians. I advise them, for one thing, if they really desire to come out from the world, to remember that the shortest path is not always the path of duty. To quarrel with all our unconverted relatives or cut off all our old friends, to withdraw entirely from mixed societies, to live an exclusive life, to give up every act of courtesy and civility in order that we may devote ourselves to the direct work of Christ, this may all seem very right and may satisfy our consciences and save us trouble. But I venture a doubt whether it is not a selfish, lazy, self-pleasing line of conduct, and whether the true cross and true line of duty may not be to deny ourselves and adopt a very different course of action. I advise them, for another thing, if they want to come out of the world, to watch against a sour, morose, uncongenial, gloomy, unpleasant, bearish demeanor, and never to forget that there is such a thing as winning without the word, 1 Peter 3:1. Let them strive to show unconverted people that their principles, whatever may be thought of them, make them cheerful, amiable, good-tempered, unselfish, considerate of others, and ready to take interest in everything that is innocent and of good report. In short, let there be no needless separation between us and the world. In many things, I shall soon show we must be separate, but let us take care that it is separation of the right sort. If the world is offended by such separation, we cannot help it. But let us never give the world occasion to say that our separation is foolish, senseless, ridiculous, unreasonable, uncharitable, and unscriptural. Number 3. In the third place, I shall try to show what true separation from the world really is. I take up this branch of my subject with a very deep sense of its difficulty. That there is a certain line of conduct which all true Christians ought to pursue with respect to the world and the things of the world is very evident. The texts already quoted make that plain. The key to the solution of that question lies in the word separation. But of what separation consists, it is not easy to show. On some points, it is not hard to lay down particular rules. On others, it is impossible to do more than state general principles and leave everyone to apply them according to his own position in life. That is what I shall now attempt to do. A. First and foremost, he that desires to come out of the world and be separate must steadily and habitually refuse to be guided by the world's standard of right and wrong. The rule of the bulk of mankind is to go with the stream, to do as others, to follow the fashion, to keep in with the common opinion, and to set your watch by the town clock. The true Christian will never be content with such a rule as that. He may simply ask, what does the scripture say? What is written in the word of God? He will maintain firmly that nothing can be right which God says is wrong, and that the customs and opinions of his neighbors can never make that to be a trifle, which God calls serious, or that it to be no sin, which God calls sin. He will never think lightly of such things as drinking, swearing, gambling, lying, cheating, swindling, or breach of the seventh commandment, because they are common. And many say, where is the great harm? That miserable argument, everyone thinks so, everybody says so, everybody does it, everybody will be there, counts for nothing with him. Is it condemned or approved by the Bible? That is his only question. If he stands alone in the parish, town, or congregation, he will not go against the Bible. If he has to come out with a crowd from the crowd and take a position by himself, he will not flinch from it rather than disobey the Bible. This is genuine scriptural separation. B, he that desires to come out from the world and be separate must be very careful how he spends his leisure time. This is a point which at first sight appears of little importance, but the longer I live, the more I am persuaded that it deserves most serious attention. Honorable occupation and lawful business are great safeguards of the soul, and the time that is spent upon them is comparatively the time of the least danger. The devil finds it hard to get a hearing from a busy man, but when the day's work is over and leisure time arrives, then comes the hour of temptation. I do not hesitate to warn every man who wants to live a Christian life to be very careful how he spends his evenings. Evening is the time when we are naturally disposed to unbend after the labors of the day. Evening is the time when the Christian is too often tempted to lay aside his armor and consequently brings trouble on his soul. Then cometh the devil, and with the devil the world. Evening is the time when the poor man is tempted to go out and fall into sin. Evening is the time that the tradesman too often sits for hours hearing and seeing things which do him no good. Evening is the time for dancing, idle games, and the like, and consequently some never get to bed until late at night. If we love our souls and would not become worldly, let us mind how we spend our evenings. Tell me how a man spends his evenings, and I can generally tell what his character is. The true Christian would do well to make it a settled rule never to waste his evenings. Whatever others may do, let him resolve always to make time for quiet, calm thought, for Bible reading and prayer. This rule will prove a hard one to keep. It may bring on him the charge of being unsocial and overly strict. Let him not mind this. Anything of this kind is better than habitual 8 hours in company, hurried prayer, slovenly Bible reading, and a bad conscience. Even if he stands alone in his church or town, let him not depart from this his rule. He will find himself in a minority and be thought a peculiar man. But this is genuine scriptural separation. C. He that desires to come out from the world and be separate must steadily and habitually determine not to be swallowed up and absorbed in the business of the world. A true Christian will strive to do his duty in whatever station or position he finds himself and to do it well. Whether statesman, merchant, banker, lawyer, doctor, or tradesman, or farmer, he will try to do his work so that no one can find occasion for fault in him. But he will not allow it to get in between him and Christ. If he finds his business beginning to eat up his Sundays, his Bible reading, or his private prayer, and to bring clouds between him and the heaven, he will say, "Stand back, there is a limit. Hitherto thou mayest go, but no farther. I cannot sell myself for place, fame, or gold." Like Daniel, he will make time for his communion with God, whatever the cost may be. Like Havelock, he will deny himself anything rather than lose his Bible reading and his prayers. In all this, he will find he stands almost alone. Many will laugh at him and tell him they get on well enough without being so strict and particular. He will not heed it. He will resolutely hold the world's arm at length, whatever present loss or sacrifice it may seem to entail. He will choose rather to be less rich and prosperous in this world than not to prosper about his soul. To stand alone in this way and to run counter in the ways of others requires immense self-denial, but there is genuine scriptural separation. This is genuine scriptural separation. D. He that desires to come out and be separate from the world must steadily abstain from all amusements and recreations which are inseparably connected with sin. This is a hard subject to handle, and I approach it with pain. But I do not think I would be faithful to Christ and faithful to my office as a minister if I did not speak very plainly about it, in considering such a matter as separation from the world. Conscience, no doubt, is a strange thing, and every man must judge for himself and use his liberty. One man sees no harm in things which others regard with abhorrence as evil. I can only give my own opinion for what it is worth and entreat my readers to consider seriously what I say. The question is whether certain amusements, as they are now conducted, are not inseparably bound up with things that are downright wicked. I entreat all professing Christians to remember this and to take heed what they do. I warn them that they must not talk of separation from the world if they can lend their sanction to amusements which are invariably connected with gambling, drunkenness, and fornication. These are things which God will judge. The end of these things is death, Hebrews 13:4 and Romans 6:21. Hard words these, no doubt. But are they not true? It may seem to your relatives and friends very straight-laced, strict and narrow, if you tell them you cannot go somewhere with them. We must fall back on first principles. Is the world a danger to the soul, or is it not? These are questions which can only be answered in one way. If we love our souls, we must have nothing to do with amusements which are bound up with sin. Nothing short of this can be called genuine scriptural separation from the world. E. He that desires to come out from the world and be separate must be moderate in the use of lawful and innocent recreations. No sensible Christian will ever think of condemning all recreations. In a world of wear and tear like we live in, occasional unbending and relaxation are good for all. Body and mind alike require serious seasons of light occupation and opportunities of letting off high spirits, and especially when they are young. Exercise itself is a positive necessity for the preservation of mental and bodily health. I see no harm in cricket, rowing, running, and other athletic recreations. I find no fault with those who play at chess and such games of skill. We are all filthily and wonderfully made. No wonder the poet says, "Strange that a harp of a thousand strings should keep in tune so long." Anything that strengthens nerves and brain and digestion and lungs and muscles and makes us more fit for Christ's work, so long as it is not in itself sinful, is a blessing and ought to be used thankfully. Anything which will occasionally divert our thoughts from their usual grinding channel in a healthy manner is a good and not an evil. But it is the excess of these innocent things which a true Christian must watch against if he wants to be separate from the world. He must not devote his whole heart, soul, mind, strength, and time to them, as many do, if he wishes to serve Christ. There are hundreds of lawful things which are good in moderation, but bad when taken in excess. Healthful medicine in small quantities, downright poison when swallowed down in huge doses. In nothing is so true as the matter of recreations. The use of them is one thing and the abuse of them is another. The Christian who uses them must know when to stop and when to say enough. Do they interfere with his private religion? Do they take up too much of his thoughts and attention? Have they a secularizing effect on his soul? Have they a tendency to pull him down to earth? Then let him hold hard and take care. All this require courage, self-denial, and firmness. It is a line of conduct which will often bring, excuse me, on us the ridicule and contempt of those who know not what moderation is, and who spend their lives in making trifles of serious things and serious things of trifles. But if we mean to come out from the world, we must not mind this. We must be temperate, even in lawful things, whatever others may think of us. This is a genuine scriptural separation. F. Last but not least, he that desires to come out from the world and be separate must be careful how he allows himself in friendships, intimacies, and close relationships with worldly people. We cannot help meeting many unconverted people as long as we live. We cannot avoid interacting with them and doing business with them unless we go out of the world, 1 Corinthians 5:10. To treat them with utmost courtesy, kindness, and charity, whenever we do meet them, is a positive duty. But acquiescence is one thing, and intimate friendship is quite another. To seek their society without cause, to choose their company, to cultivate close friendships with them is very dangerous to the soul. Human nature is so constituted that we cannot be much with other people without effect on our own character. The old proverb will never fail to prove true. Tell me whom a man chooses to live, and I will tell him what he is. The scripture says expressly, he that walketh with the wise will be wise, but a companion of fools shall be destroyed. Proverbs 13:20. If then a Christian who desires to live consistently chooses for his friends those who do not care for their souls, or the Bible, or God, or Christ, or holiness, or regard them as of secondary importance, it seems to me impossible for him to prosper in his religion. He will soon find that their ways are not his ways, nor their thoughts his thoughts, nor their tastes his tastes, and that unless they change, he must give up close friendship with them. In short, there must be separation. Of course, such separation will be painful. But if we have to choose between the loss of a friend and the injury of our souls, there ought to be no doubt in our minds. If friends will not walk in the narrow way with us, we must not walk in the broad way to please them. But let us distinctly understand that to attempt to keep up close friendship between a converted and an unconverted person, if both are consistent with their natures, is to attempt an impossibility. The principle laid down here ought to be carefully remembered by all unmarried Christians in the choice of a husband or wife. I fear it is too often entirely forgotten. Too many seem to think of everything except religion and choosing a partner for life, or to suppose that it will come somehow as a matter of course. Yet when a praying, Bible-reading, God-fearing, Christ-loving, Sabbath-keeping Christian marries a person who takes no interest whatever in serious religion, what can the result but be injury to the Christian or immense unhappiness? Health is not infectious, but disease is. As a general rule, in such cases, the good go down to the level of the bad, and the bad do not come up to the level of the good. The subject is a delicate one, but I do not care to dwell upon it. But this I say confidently to every unmarried Christian man or woman. If you love your soul, if you do not want to fall away and backslide, if you do not want to destroy your own peace and comfort for life, resolve never to marry any person who is not a thorough Christian, whatever the resolution may cost you. You had better die than marry an unbeliever. Stand to this resolution and let no one ever persuade you out of it. Depart from this resolution and you will find it almost impossible to come out and be separate. But you will find you have tied a millstone around your neck in running the race towards heaven. And if saved at last, it will be so as through fire. 1 Corinthians 3:15. I offer these six general hints to all who wish to follow Paul's advice and to come out from the world and be separate. And giving them, I lay no claim to infallibility, but I believe they deserve consideration and attention. I do not forget that the subject is full of difficulties and that scores of doubtful cases are continually arising in a Christian's course, in which it is very hard to say what is the path of duty and how to behave. Perhaps the following bits of advice may be useful. In all doubtful cases, we should first pray for wisdom and sound judgment. If prayer is worth anything, it must be especially valuable when we desire to do right. But we do not see our way, but do not see our way. In all doubtful cases, let us often try ourselves by recollecting the eye of God. Would I go to such and such a place or do such and such a thing? If I really thought God was looking at me. In all doubtful cases, let us never forget the second advent of Christ and the day of judgment. Shall I like to be found in such and such a company or employed in such and such ways? Finally, in all doubtful cases, let us find out what the conduct of the holiest and best Christians have been under similar circumstances. If we do not clearly see our own way, we need not be ashamed to follow good examples. I throw out these suggestions for the use of all who are in difficulties about disputable points in the matter of separation from the world. I cannot help thinking that they may help to untie many knots and solve many problems. Number four, I shall now conclude the whole subject by trying to show the secret of real victory over the world. To come out from the world, of course, is not an easy thing. It cannot be easy so long as human nature is what it is, with a busy devil always near us. It requires a constant struggle and exertion. It entails incessant conflict and self-denial. It often places us in exact opposition to members of our own families and neighbors. It sometimes obliges us to do things which give great offense and bring on us ridicule and petty persecution. It is precisely this which makes many hang back and shrink from decided religion. They know they are not right. They know that they are not so thorough in Christ's service as they ought to be, and they feel uncomfortable and ill at ease. But the fear of man keeps them back, and so they linger on through life with aching, dissatisfied hearts, with too much religion to be happy in the world, and too much of the world to be happy in their religion. I fear this is a very common case if the truth were known. If there are some in every age who seem to get the victory over the world, they come out decidedly from their ways and are unmistakably separate. They are independent of its opinions and unshaken by its opposition. They move on like planets in the orbit of their own and seem to be rise up equally above the world's smiles and frowns. And what are the secrets of their victory? I will set them down. A. The first secret of victory over the world is the right heart. By that I mean a heart renewed, changed, and sanctified by the Holy Spirit. A heart in which Christ dwells. A heart in which the old things have passed away and all things have become new. The grand mark of such a heart is the bias of its tastes and affections. The owner of such a heart no longer likes the world and the things of the world, and therefore finds it no trial or sacrifice to give them up. He has no longer any appetite for the company, the conversation, the amusements, the occupations, the books which he once loved, and to come out from them seems natural to him. Great indeed is the expulsive power of a new principle. Just as the new spring buds in a beech hedge push out the old leaves and make them quietly fall to the ground, so does the new heart of a believer invariably affect the tastes and likings and make him drop many things which he once loved and lived in, because he now likes them no more. Let him that wants to come out from the world and be separate make sure, first and foremost, that he has got a new heart. If the heart is really right, everything else will be right in time. If the eye be single, thy whole body shall be full of light. Matthew 6:22. If the affections are not right, there never will be right action. B. The second secret of victory over the world is a lively, practical faith in unseen things. What does the scripture say? 1 John 5:4. This is the victory that overcometh the world, even our faith. To attain and keep up the habit of looking steadily at invisible things as if they were visible. To set before our minds every day the grand realities, our souls, God, Christ, heaven, hell, judgment, eternity. To cherish an abiding conviction that what we do not only is just as real, that what we do not see is just as real as what we do see, and 10,000 times more important. This is one way to be conquerors over the world. This is the faith which made the noble army of saints described in Hebrews 11 obtain such a glorious testimony from the Holy Spirit. They all acted under a firm persuasion that they had a real God, a real Savior, and a real home in heaven, though unseen by mortal eyes. Armed with this faith, a man regards his world as a shadow compared to the world to come and cares little for its praise or blame or its enmity or its rewards. Let him that wants to come out of the world and be separate, but shrinks and hangs back for fear of the things seen, pray and strive to have this faith. Mark 9:23, all things are possible to him that believeth. Like Moses, he will find it possible to forsake Egypt, seeing him that is invisible. Like Moses, he will not care what he loses and who is displeased, because he sees from afar off. Like when looking through a telescope, a substantial recompense of reward, Hebrews 11:26. See, the third and last secret of victory over the world is to attain and cultivate the habit of boldly confessing Christ on all proper occasions. In saying this, I would not be mistaken. I want no one to blow the trumpet before him and thrust his religion on others at all seasons, but to wish to encourage all who strive to come out from the world to show their true colors and to act and speak like men who are not ashamed to serve Christ. A steady, quiet assertion of our principles, our own principles as Christians, a habitual readiness to let the children of this world see that we are guided by other rules than they are and do not mean to swerve from them. A calm, firm, courteous maintenance of our own standards in every company. All this will insensibly form a habit within us and make it comparatively easy to be a separate man. It'll be hard at first, no doubt, and cause us many a struggle. But the longer we go on, the easier it will be. Repeated acts of confessing Christ will produce habits. Habits once formed will produce a settled character. Our characters once known, we will be saved much trouble. Men will know what to expect from us and will not count it strange if they see us living lives of separate people. He that grasps the nettle most firmly will always be hurt less than the man who touches it with a trembling hand. It is a great thing to be able to say no, decidedly, but courteously, when asked to do something, anything, which conscience says is wrong. He that shows his colors boldly from the first and is never ashamed to let men see whose he is and whom he serves will soon find that he has overcome the world and will let it be alone. Bold confession is a long step towards victory. It only remains for me now to conclude the whole subject with a few short words of application. The danger of the world ruining the soul and the nature of true separation from the world, the secrets of victory over the world, are all before the reader. I now ask him to give me his attention for the last time while I try to say something directly for his personal benefit. Number one, my first word shall be a question. Are you overcoming the world? Are you overcome by it? Do you know what it is to come out from the world and be separate, or are you yet entangled by it and conformed to it? If you have a desire to be saved, I entreat you to answer this question. If you know nothing of separation, I warn you affectionately that your soul is in great danger. The world passeth away, and they who cling to the world and think only of the world will pass away with it, to everlasting ruin. Awake to know your peril before it is too late. Awake and flee from the wrath to come. The time is short. The end of all things is at hand. The shadows are lengthening. The sun is going down. The night cometh with no man can work. The great white thrones will be soon be set. The judgment will begin. The books will be opened. Awake and come out from the world while it is called today. Yet a little while, and there will be no more worldly occupations and worldly amusements, no more getting money and spending money, no more eating, drinking, feasting, dressing, theaters, races, cards, and gambling. What will you do when all these things have passed away forever? How can you possibly be happy in the eternal heaven when holiness is all in all and worldliness has no place? Ah, consider these things and be wise. Awake and break the chains which the world has thrown around you. Awake and flee from the wrath to come. Number two, my second word shall be a counsel. If you want to come out from the world but do not know what to do, take the advice I give you this day. Begin by applying directly as a penitent sinner to our Lord Jesus Christ and put your case in his hands. Pour out your heart before him. Tell him your whole story and keep nothing back. Tell him that you are a sinner wanting to be saved from the world, the flesh and the devil, and entreat him to save you. The blessed Savior gave himself for us that he might deliver us from the present evil world, Galatians 1:2. He knows what the world is, for he lived in it 33 years. He knows what the difficulties of men are, for he was made a man for our sakes and dwelt among men. High in heaven at the right hand of God, he is able to save to the uttermost all who come to God by him, able to keep us from the evil of the world whilst we are still living in it, able to give us power to become the sons of God, able to keep us from falling, able to make us more than conquerors. Once more I say, go directly to Christ with a prayer of faith and put yourself wholly and unreservedly in his hands. Hard as it may seem to you to come out from the world and be separate, you shall find that with Jesus nothing is impossible. You, even you, shall overcome the world. Number three, my third and last word shall be encouragement. If you have learned by experience what it is to come out from the world, I can only say to you, take comfort and persevere. You are on the right road. You have no cause to be afraid. The everlasting hills are in sight. Your salvation is nearer than when you believe. Take comfort and press on. No doubt you have had many a battle and made many a false step. You have sometimes felt ready to faint and been half disposed to go back to Egypt. But your master has never entirely left you, and he will never suffer you to be tempted above what you are able to bear. So persevere steadily in your separation from the world and never be ashamed of standing alone. Settle it firmly in your mind that the most decided Christians are always the happiest. And remember that no one ever said at the end of the course that he had been too holy or lived too near to God. Here, last of all, what is written in the scriptures of truth. Luke 12:8. Whoever shall confess me before men, him shall the Son of Man also confess before the angels of God. Mark 10:29-30. There is no man that hath left house, or brethren, or sisters, or fathers, or mother, or wife, or children, or lands, for my sake in the Gospels, but he shall receive 100-fold now in this time houses, and brethren, and sisters, and mother, and children, and lands, with persecutions, and in the world to come, eternal life. Hebrews 10:35-37. Cast not away, therefore, your confidence, which hath great recompense of reward, for you have need of patience, that after ye have done the will of God, ye might receive the promise. For yet a little while, and he that shall come will come and will not tarry. Those words were spoken and were written and spoken for our sakes. Let us lay hold on them, and let us never forget them. Let us persevere to the end and never be ashamed of coming out from the world and being separate. We may be sure it brings its own reward. Let us pray. Father, we give you thanks for this great message from your servant, J.C. Ryle. We ask that you would apply it to our hearts. Convict us, Lord, where we fall short. Help us to consistently and habitually live separate lives in the world. And in any areas where we fall short, cause us to repent daily, to die daily, to put those things behind us, to replace ungodly habits with godly habits, to replace sinful activities with holy activities, that we would live a life pleasing in thy sight. Help us, Lord, to be obedient to your dear Son, Jesus Christ. In his name we pray. Amen.